thank you very much for a very kind introduction, and it's really nice to be with all of you and to join the Marin Coalition this afternoon. I'm going to give you a brief update about just what's going on globally, in a sense, in Sacramento, and then we can also talk about things that that are more interesting to you, and I'll try to limit some of my comments because I think that this is a crowd that will have some really good questions, and you may stump me, and I may have to phone a friend, or you know, get a lifeline if you remember those shows that had that. So I think the one of the things, you know, as I'm working in the assembly, and I can't believe it's been over 3 years now. It really has gone by an incredibly fast pace since my election in 2012. We've just elected a new speaker elect. So you know, this is the term limits changed. In 2012, it used to be that you could serve 6 years in the Assembly and then 8 years in the Senate if you can find a Senate seat to run for, or 8 years in the Senate and then an Assembly seat if you could run for. Now you can serve 12 years in any of the houses, or divide it up in any way, 4 in 1, 12 in the other. I plan on spending, if I'm going to be there for 12 years, all in the Assembly. But we because of this change, we're predicting that we won't change leadership as often. But that's not necessarily the case. But we just selected what will be our third speaker in my time in the assembly, and he will take office next month. His name is Anthony Rendon. He represents an area called Lakewood, and if you can find that on a map, he'd be pretty good at California geography. It is a district that is east of Long Beach and south of Los Angeles. Anthony's actually a really bright individual. He was elected in 2012 alongside me, and he was my seatmate during my second year in the assembly. He'll be replacing Tony Atkins from San Diego, who is termed out of the assembly with the older term limits and is running for the Senate to represent San Diego County, coastal San Diego County, and she'll do a fantastic job there as well. She's been a delight to serve with as speaker. We also had just recently the State of the State address by Governor Brown that paired with the timing for the governor's budget proposal. And I want to tell you a little bit about what's in that budget proposal. It's a starting point for budget negotiations. And in May, after we have a better sense of projections for revenue, then the governor will revise his budget proposal. That's called the May Revise. And that will really inform budget negotiations, which will really start in earnest, the way that I've experienced it, in June. And we usually pass it in early June as the fiscal year begins July 1st. But everything really happens at the end, right? Until you have that time pressure of a deadline, you don't have the motivation, perhaps, or the leverage, or the pressure to get a deal done. And it would be nice if it was somewhat different, if we could figure out the best policy and know months in advance, this is how we're going to do it. But usually it's what a lot of the decisions are deadline driven. That might sound familiar for a lot of the things that we experience. In the governor's budget, the total size is $171 billion. Of that, $71.6 billion is for schools and education funding. This is the highest level of K-12 funding we've ever had in the state of California. And there's another $300 million for career technical education, which will hopefully mean, from my perspective, that when you earn a high school diploma, that it means something and that you can do something with it. And I think that's where CTE, career technical education, can really come into play. We have a lot of emphasis on college. Not everyone does go to college, but of course every student from Marin should go to college and get a college degree. But across the state of California, there's a diversity in what people's education goals are and what jobs they want to get into. And this is a very important way to build a middle class for skilled and highly skilled jobs. We're also focusing, and Frida had mentioned, managed care organization tax and Medi-Cal. About 15 million Californians that rely on Medi-Cal and covered California. It's a staggering number of people in our state that rely on those things. In fact, nearly half of all of California's children are on Medi-Cal. Blew me away when I learned that. I did not know that until last year. and it's nearly a third of all Californians that rely on Medi-Cal. It's a significant number, and this really this issue really became significant for our state because the Obama administration, we have a tax on managed care organizations, and the Obama administration informed California that our tax does not meet their guidelines for matching funds, which meant that the federal government would withhold about $1.2 billion that they were matching from that tax, and that's why we had the tax, was to leverage matching funds from the federal government. So they're going to take that away. It's a significant amount of money. I mean, you know, our annual budget's general fund, $171 billion, and so 1.2 is, it's real cuts, and some people might think it's not that big of a number. It's a big number. And so we needed to engage the managed care organizations, Anthem, Blue Cross, Kaiser, United, and others, to say, you know, we need to have a way to change the tax system that we have. So the old tax system was interesting. We only taxed the insurers that provided Medi-Cal. When the federal government said, that's not fair. You have to tax every plan. And so people that didn't have any Medi-Cal patients needed to start charging this tax. And so that was one of the proposals that we had. And it looks like we may be landing this in the next week or so, where the big ones like Anthem, Blue Cross will agree to a tax to generate the $1.2 billion. They may be offset in a bit of a shell game in some tax credits they get in some other area of their operations, so that they don't have to increase health insurance costs. And that's what a lot of the insurers were concerned about. If they have to pay $7 or $15 per insured life and per person per month, how do you do that and absorb that that cost? Now, of course, they make a lot of profit. They probably could, but it would have meant less money for their shareholders. And so we're trying to figure out a way to leverage the $1.2 billion in federal funds without increasing health insurance fees for everyone who is covered. So pretty significant to be able to do this, and it's taken a lot of time from the legislature, and it's one of those issues. Governor Brown was asked this when he laid out his budget proposal by a journalist, you know, can you explain to me the deal on the MCO tax? And he said, well, I can't tell you because you wouldn't understand. And then he caught himself, because I couldn't explain it well. I mean, it's not an easy thing to actually talk about, and I don't know if I've been able to articulate it. It's incredibly complicated, but it's going to affect a lot of people, as I mentioned, how nearly half of California's kids rely on Medi-Cal. If we lose that $1.2 billion in funding, what will we cut to make up that hole? And it's significant. Another thing that the legislature had negotiated and actually put on the ballot in 2014 was a rainy day fund. And that was passed. I think it was passed overwhelmingly by more than the water bond. And so we're putting in this year $2 billion into that rainy day fund for a total of $8 billion that we've set aside. Again, it sounds like that's a big number, and it is. That, if you put that into perspective of some of the deficits we ran during the Great Recession, we had annual deficits in the double digits, even surpassing $20 million in any given year. So this $8 billion reserve will lessen cuts in the future, but it will not stop any cuts from happening. This is going to be difficult to explain to Californians who thought, well, did we vote for this rainy day fund, and aren't we putting money aside? And the answer is, well, yes, we did, and we are putting money aside, and this is going to be good for us, but it will not alleviate the need in future recessions to make cuts. And that's an important public dialogue for us to have. The other thing is, as we look at the size of the budget and where we're spending our money, there are some issues that we are not resolving. So we've tried to do some things for unfunded liabilities, and in particular, you know, pensions and long-term healthcare costs, both for our school districts and for the state, and also for localities, because the law that was passed in 2012 affects municipalities and districts. But we still have about $220 billion in unfunded liabilities pension and healthcare that the state is going to need to look at, and that will, you know, significantly overwhelm us in the next recession. It's not going away. Even though revenues are at their highest, our spending on schools are at their highest, we do have other costs that we'll be needing to deal with. The other significant thing, of course, is that I was asked by Speaker Atkins to chair the Water Parks and Wildlife Committee last year, and of course we were in the midst of the most the deepest most historic drought in recorded history for California, and I did try to talk her out of appointing me to that committee, and she stuck me with it. And yesterday I conducted my second oversight hearing on the water bond that was passed in 2014. It's a $7.5 billion water bond. And it's interesting because we're not able to shovel all that money out immediately. People think, well, it's the middle of the drought. We just passed this bond. Isn't this going to save us? And the answer is the water bond was never meant to save us from this drought, but it was meant to be a down payment for long-term water sustainability and water security for the state of California. And so will we be better off in the next drought because of how we're spending this money? And that is what the test is going to be, not whether this has direct impacts today for the current drought. And it's difficult to spend $7.5 billion responsibly and targeted and in a quick way. You know, a lot of these things take time. And so in particular, when we were looking at the storage component, which now in the previously negotiated bond back in 2009, it was all surface storage. And there's a lot of other storage that we can use more efficiently, more economically, like groundwater storage. And so in the bond that we negotiated, it actually says that that $2.5 billion can be used for groundwater storage in the San Fernando Valley. There's a significant amount of storage, about 3 million acre feet, that was contaminated by the aerospace industry. But with $1 billion investment, a great portion of that storage can be reclaimed. And so we don't need to dig a big hole somewhere that we hope snow will fall at or that rain will fall at. We actually have this as a resource in these, you know, aquifers that exist naturally. And it also gives us an opportunity to invest in where we think water will come in the future. So we don't know if we'll have the snowpack that we've always relied upon for a third of our water storage, which, you know, is very efficient and cheap. You didn't have to dig a hole for that either. But we don't know if the snow will come. We don't know where the rain will come. But we know that we're always going to be using water. And I think that if we make investments, it's funny for a Marin guy to say, let's make these investments in LA, but let me tell you why. All the rain that goes into LA, about 80% just goes right into the ocean. And so if we start looking at stormwater capture, recycled water, and then storing that into these aquifers, if we can reduce LA's reliance on Delta water by 1 million acre feet a year, and I think that we can, that puts a whole lot less stress and strain on the Delta ecosystem that we care so much about, and also provides, I think, both environmental benefits, but even more certainty for water by agricultural interests that are also important to sustain for our economy. The agricultural interests don't completely buy that, and let me tell you why, at least in theory for me. They like the surface storage because they can see the water. I think it's as simple as that. It's very traditional. They know where the water is, and they feel like they can really have some claim over what their water rights are when they've got it up in those areas. In LA, they still don't know if they can rely on getting the water supply they need from Northern California with the water conveyance system that we have. And that opens up a whole other hill of beans, or can of worms, however you want to put it. And we can probably talk about that a little bit longer too. The other thing that we're focusing on, the governor called a special session on that MCO tax issue, the healthcare issue. He also called a special session on infrastructure. And he's been trying to create a tax on gas, a higher tax on gas, but also a highway user fee of $65 for every vehicle to make up for the fact that we're using less gas because we've got better mileage in our vehicles. This is a very difficult thing to accomplish because raising fees and taxes requires a two-thirds vote of the legislature, and we don't have that. Meaning there's not, two-thirds of the legislature won't vote for it. I don't know if every Democrat would vote for it, but we also need Republican votes, and I don't think they're gonna vote for it. So I have an idea, and I'll be introducing legislation based on this idea. There is, when we're spending money on infrastructure in our state, we've got about $6 billion that we need to do just to maintain what we have, not to build new infrastructure. And we all know that our roads and highways are not maintained at the right level. When we pay for that, about half of every infrastructure dollar, or transportation infrastructure dollars specifically, goes to interest on debt, because we finance this infrastructure with bonds. And this costs money, and we're paying fees to banks, to Wall Street investors, and I think that we can do a whole lot better. So my idea is this: we guarantee one entity a specific return on investment no matter what, and that's CalPERS. We guarantee them, the taxpayer, we guarantee them a 7.5% return on investment to make sure that the pensions are whole. So my idea is to qualify infrastructure investments in the state of California where we guarantee that rate of return to CalPERS. It doesn't have to be 7.5%. It could be a 4.5% more modest risk investment. We don't have to guarantee the full 7.5%. But I think that at the rate at which we're financing our bonds, we could even guarantee above 7.5% and save money, because it's not going to interest to Wall Street. And so I'll be introducing that piece of legislation in the coming weeks, and I'd be interested to hear what you think about it. It would be funding our unfunded liabilities. It would be creating jobs in California. Oh, and by the way, we would have infrastructure to show for all of that work. And we're paying that 7.5% regardless. So why not have something to show for it? And so I think at that point, there are probably a lot of other hot button issues that you'd love to ask me about, but I wanted to give some time for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. So I'll grab this other microphone and see if we can get it to go into the audience. Okay. Let's see if this is working.
Okay, this one works too? Yes. Okay, so I'm gonna move through the room to take questions. I'll start over here and then kind of work through and try to make sure we get every table to have a chance for at least one question from each one of the tables. You've given us so much to think about, so let's see where we can dive in. I'll start over here with Wendy.
And Stan, I'm sure it just sort of helps everybody hear your question. As well as speaking with a microphone, right?
Yes, I'm Amy Willard, and I wrote a letter to Mike McGuire that I copied you on, so you may have seen it, but I'll, for the benefit of everyone else here. It was about a proposal for... There was a vote at the December Transportation Authority of Marin board meeting to have a consultant or a lobbyist place on the desk of McGuire a piece of legislation that they were hoping he would introduce to raise the cap specifically for Marin on the sales tax at the county level, above the 2%, which is now mandated as the tax on county-specific sales taxes in the state. And the idea would be to get extra money into TAM with this. And my concern is that this is a regressive tax, and I'm wondering what would be your response to this when it comes over to your part of the legislature.
Yeah, well, thanks for the question. I'm not familiar with it, so I'd have to see what their proposal is to give a proper or adequate response. Thank you.
Okay, any question here at this table for right now?
The question is about the fracking and the how many places are clean and pure where you know that you could put that water into the ground where it wasn't really being contaminated by something that was already fracked or something that was already bad. I think when you can't see what's happening, the concern is you're just contaminating everything?
That's a really good question, and you know, we need to have more controls on fracking, and I you know, passed legislation to help monitor that and also find out what chemicals are in fracking fluids as well. And so obviously science is something that we would rely on to find out if groundwater aquifers have been poisoned or contaminated and whether it's a safe thing for us to do. We have enormous groundwater reserves in the state of California. We rely on those groundwater reserves every year, not just in drought years. And we've, in fact, over-relied on groundwater. And so we passed, for the very first time in California, Groundwater Sustainability Management Act. And so we will know what we're doing with our groundwater for the first time because of that bill, and will put us in a much better place. We've had, particularly because of the over-reliance on groundwater subsidence throughout our state, where the ground has actually gone down, and we end up losing that water storage because of it. So recharging those aquifers will help us stop future subsidence, which will be another benefit.
You know, I want to harp again on one of my favorite complaints, which is Highway 101. And I think that this is the elephant in the room. It's creating a huge amount of business loss for the people who are actually doing business in Marin County. I think after about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, people just can't get around anymore. And this is a responsibility at the state and federal level. But I really don't see the attention being paid to this at the state level, and I'm wondering if you have been able to light any fires in Sacramento to take some serious action on this, and if you haven't been successful at that, why, and what can we do to help?
Well, thank you for that question, Clayton. I've been very active, actually, on transportation infrastructure in Marin. In particular, one of the causes of the backup every afternoon on 101, the Richmond Bridge, and getting that third lane that was built originally with three lanes reopened. Caltrans, if they had their way, and they will, wants to do an EIR on whether or not to open up the third lane. And they, you know, it was built that way. And of course, after the Loma Prieta earthquake, you know, it was closed because of the drought in the 70s. They put a pipe across it. And then when they removed the pipe, they kept it closed. And then after the Loma Prieta earthquake, they opened it up right away because of the Bay Bridge being closed. Then they closed it again. So this third lane, actually, it is a third lane. So they wanted to take their time to do an EIR on how to reopen the third lane. Then after the EIR is approved, they wanted to then design the third lane. Yes, that is the appropriate response. So I had a bill to allow them to do the design work at the same time as the environmental work, and even then people were flipping out because, you know, how can you do this? And I had another assembly member from the East Bay say, you can't do a one-off project like that for your community. What about the rest of the state? My response was, where else is there a three-lane bridge that we want to reopen a bridge or reopen the lane? It's not like we're building a new bridge, and we're not even building a new lane. So we got this bill through, and regardless of a whole lot of stupidity, and the governor signed it, and a lot of people were working to try to get this bill vetoed, including Supervisor Kinsey, who was not a fan of green lighting this third lane. He'd like to take a lot of credit for it, but he doesn't like expediting any of this stuff, because I think he's just a little too cozy with the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, which he's probably going to get a job with when he retires from the Board of Supervisors. I could keep doing this. This is fun. So, remember that time Steve Kinsey tried to keep us in a metropolitan housing designation? Yeah. All right. It's just that it keeps on giving us more to talk about. So, you know, we got that through. But I think that MTC and Caltrans can open that lane immediately. There's nothing stopping them. And they say, well, on the Richmond side, there's this retaining wall, and you've got to, you know, you can't, the sight lines aren't very good. You've got to move the retaining wall. And I just look at the Presidio Parkway, the old Doyle Drive. They dropped that down to 35 miles per hour. Look at Golden Gate Bridge, 45 miles per hour. So is traffic at 3 p.m. or 6 p.m. on the Richmond Bridge going faster than 35 miles per hour? No. So drop the speed limit during the hours that third lane is open, and everyone's going to be safe, and they're going to get home to their families. They're going to be able to eat dinner with their kids, help them out with their homework, and get people home. But Caltrans and MTC just don't have it in them to expedite this. And let me tell you why. This is how stupid they are. They have a contract with the bridge painter. And they allow the painter of the, you know, the people that do the paint on the bridge to park their equipment in the third lane. So, you know, you're driving by, you're, what is all this equipment doing here? Now, do you see equipment parked on one of the lanes of the Golden Gate Bridge? No way. Do you see that on the Bay Bridge? No, not a single bridge. Over in Carquinez Bridge, Benicia Bridge, no, it's just pure stupidity that they allow that lane to be used for storing equipment. So I met with the director of Caltrans. I met with the secretary of transportation. I, of course, met with Steve Heminger from the MTC and Steve Kinsey. And you know, I said, let's be creative, guys. Let's get this thing open. And they do not bring ideas to it. And they've got, you know, they've got no energy to make this thing work. It's
bizarre.
If there
were people in this audience who wanted to take action on this, what action could anybody in this room take?
I say we hold hands and stand on the bridge. That gets a lot of people's attention, right? So you know, I did another bill to get their attention. I said, let's dissolve the MTC. And you know what? The MTC board voted to oppose that bill. Surprise, surprise, surprise. That bill's going nowhere. But it got their attention. It's been, you know, the Contra Costa Times did an editorial about it. The San Jose Mercury News did an editorial about it. Of course, the Marin Independent Journal has as well. And it got a lot of people's attention because they certainly can do a whole lot of a better job.
Okay, so we've got a bunch more questions, I know. So I'm going to go to this one.
Cheryl Anjanani.
Hi.
I appreciate your efforts to expedite that third lane, and I especially appreciate your efforts to bring more accountability to MTC. I think it really does need restructuring. I am concerned about the third lane on the bridge. I think it's oversold. Mm-hmm. It's not going to solve our transportation problems, even along Sir Francis Drake, just there. Mm-hmm. Every time you increase capacity, it eventually fills up, induces more people to drive. And so we're going to have, you know, in 5 or 10 years after that third lane's open, in 5 years it'll be clogged. So what are we doing to get a real connection between 580 and 101?
Yeah, well, I think you're absolutely right. It won't solve all of our traffic problems. The studies show that it will make things better. But, you know, what TAM does with that interchange area in Greenbrae or in San Rafael with the connector at Bellum is something that's going to help out a whole lot more. And I know that, of course, that they're doing some redesign on Sir Francis Drake as well. I don't know if that will actually help with traffic all that much. But the Transportation Authority of Marin is where a lot of these decisions are being made. And so I recommend that you really focus there. And, you know, I'll do everything I can to help make things better, you know, if there's a proposal to you know, actually act on these things. The reason why I really focus on the Richmond Bridge, it is cheap and easy to do. It doesn't require a lot of money. I'm not looking for $200 million. And that's why it's a low-hanging fruit.
Jack mentioned, Mark, I'm not sure of the number anymore, but I think it was Senate Bill 331 involving transparency. And when I first learned of it, it had already passed the Senate, and I never thought it would go any further than that, and it did. It's the one that required cities, if they were going to adopt a coin, some form of transparency, that they would, as you know, then be penalized by having to follow procedures that were very punitive. I didn't think it would pass. You didn't vote for it, thank goodness. But it passed the Assembly. And then, lo and behold, the governor signed it. Would you care to comment on how that happened?
It happened exactly how you described it, and I believe Senator McGuire also voted against that. And so you had your North Bay delegation, you know, really in opposition to that bill. It would have, the bill was very funny. It was called Crony. I just thought, as soon as I, you know, you start reading the bill, like, oh, maybe this makes sense, maybe this doesn't make sense. Oh, the acronym is Crony, then the joke's on all of us when someone actually writes that into the bill. And it would have made it very difficult for local agencies and cities to engage in any type of collective bargaining with transparency if they, with Crony being there, because then they would have had all of their like bid processes made public as well. But the whole point of the bid is so that people don't know what the other bids are, so you can get the lowest bid possible. And so I did not anticipate that the governor would sign it, and he did, and I think many of us were surprised, just like you were, Jack.
Is that because of the labor unions?
I don't know. I, you know, there are a lot of things that I could say I'm going to blame them on, and I suppose that could be one of them. I don't really know the backstory on what negotiation it was. You know, what did he give up? What did they give up? He signs this bill. He vetoes some other bill of theirs. And I'm just not familiar with what trade-offs may have been there.
Hi, Mark. Larry Burnworth. Just a quick comment on your education proposals, things of this nature.
Yeah.
Well, I think you're heading in the right direction on many of them. The universities are turning out folks with master's degrees in education, and the state of California still requires anyone who is going to be a teacher, substitute teacher, whatever, to take the CBEST exam. Frankly, the CBEST exam is aimed at third graders with respect to the math, the reading comprehension, writing capabilities, and we still have teachers that are taking that 4, 5, 10 times and still can't pass it. What's going on at the universities? That this is where the education problem, I believe, lies. That we're not turning out the best people.
I am not familiar with the CBEST issue specifically, but even back when I was in college 20 years ago, I was the chairman of the California State Student Association. And at the meetings that I would go to, the numbers of students graduating high school, going to a UC or a CSU that needed remediation or basic skills education was staggeringly high. And that hasn't changed at all. And so, you know, it's, you can't really blame the universities at that point. It's, you know, the preparation of a life. And so when do you do that? And do you do that in early childhood education? Do you do that in K-3? Critical years, particularly for reading comprehension, and so, you know, I am working as hard as I can to make sure that people can learn in a method that works for them. And so for the past 2 years, I authored legislation on something called blended learning. And blended learning just recognizes that all students don't learn the same way. You may learn sitting in a classroom with a teacher in front of you. There's a school in Long Beach that is right next to Boeing. And so, you know, they've got people learning engineering and they don't have to be in a classroom doing it. They can go over to Boeing literally across the street and have an experience of, you know, how do you apply these skills in a practical sense? A lot of this is, it seems great, but not all schools are created equally. A regular traditional public school, people could go over to Boeing 2 days a week and it's not an issue, and be out of the classroom and have that. But in a charter school, they are limited to only 20% of their learning time to be out of the classroom. So, you know, this is being on site or off site. This could be doing some technology-based learning where a computer really tests your aptitude and can gauge where you're strong, where you're weak, and then give you what you need to learn more or to test what your real skill level is to get better. But if you go over 20% of that type of learning, they lose their funding for their facilities. So a regular public school, they don't even have to be in the classroom, they're gonna keep their facilities. But for that charter school, you still need to pay for that classroom, even if the child is out of the classroom for 25% of their time. And so I've authored legislation to help them do that. And of course, you know, the status quo is very powerful. And the California Teachers Association would say, well, it may be okay for traditional public schools, but a charter public school, no way. We're not going to allow them that time. So they oppose that. And again, even in my legislation, we protected jobs. No one would lose a job in the way that we authored this, but they still were in opposition because, you know, sometimes the special interests on different sides don't want any side to win. And I think that the state ends up a whole lot worse because of it.
All right, let's see what else we can throw at you from over in this corner.
Hello, Mark. I'm Hutch Turner. I have a perceived problem, which I see going on, that's very disturbing, and that's the removal of power from cities as far as planning is concerned. And it seems to me that there is a conscious effort to neutralize local input in a determinant way regarding planning for cities. And cities have traditionally been the backbone of this country, and diversity of opinion has been key. And yet, over the past few years, we have seen increasing mandates, seizure of funds by the state, and other things done which weaken the city. Is that your perception?
I think that Jack talked about a specific bill that that made things burdensome for cities and actually, you know, stopped them from being able to do some things. And I think that that example is just one of many that occur during any legislative session. And you know, there are so many different interests in Sacramento that that often cities are on the losing side. That's an accurate way to describe it.
Okay, let's see, from this table.
Hi, Mark. Brandon Barber. I'm curious about how you feel the outcome of the housing element bill came through for Marin, AB 1537. If you knew where the supervisors were coming from when you supported that bill and how you feel it, the outcome came.
So, over a decade ago, the state passed a bill, and it was in 2004, to make it easier for communities to figure out how to build affordable housing. That was the goal of the bill. So some communities would have to build at a minimum of 10 units of affordable housing per acre, suburban 20, metropolitan 30. And they thought this was going to simplify things. In Marin, because of our federal metropolitan statistical area, we were lumped in with San Francisco and Oakland as a metropolitan area. So it created this 30 unit per acre density for affordable housing minimum. And then Sonoma, you know, got 20. And what we saw over that period of time was that Marin did not actually build affordable housing. During that period, it actually didn't have a positive effect for us to do that. And it created a perception that Marin is anti-affordable housing. And so I don't think that's the case. I think that what any community is interested in is having any housing or any development, commercial or otherwise, match the character of the community that it's in. And so the problem is that if you ask any legislator or policy observer in Sacramento, they would say, oh, Marin just doesn't like affordable housing. Marin just doesn't want anyone to live there. And so the perception of that was extraordinarily damaging for efforts to change that density to anything other than 30. And so for a very long time, Marin County had asked its legislators to change that, and they were unable to do it. And then I got elected, and I'm really good, and we got it done. So you know, the perception of like what the supervisors wanted, that wasn't really what was on my mind. I knew that they wanted this done, but I needed to figure out how do we do this in a way that you get buy-in from, you know, 79 other assembly members and 40 senators, because we can't just wave a wand to make this happen. And then, of course, you know, all the different special interests that care, including affordable housing developers. So this is what we did. You know, the first year, I took the bill that my predecessor did and said, let's go try this again. We'll go march up the mountain and try to get this thing passed. And of course, we got a very bad reception. And so we looked at what I described at the beginning. Marin was not successful building any housing. The goal of that bill was to build the original bill in 2004. They were called Mullen densities after the author Gene Mullen. His son Kevin Mullen is now in the assembly. It's hereditary, apparently. And so these Mullen densities didn't have the intended effect. And in fact, the unintended consequence was no housing was built. And so we started looking at that a little bit differently, and then we approached the special interests, the affordable housing developers, and they have their own nonprofits. There are many of them that develop, but they also have advocacy arms. And we came about the issue with them to say, let's look at this issue differently. How could we encourage Marin to actually build affordable housing in a way that would not incite concern about the changing character of the community? And they seem to kind of buy that. Okay, this starts making sense. How do you build in a way that fits? And so dropping the density from 30 to 20 was a way to say, you know, let's recognize that even though 30 is not that much more than 20, and in fact some of the best developments in San Rafael in particular have many, many more than 30 units per acre, that you don't have local communities saying, why are we being stuck with this higher number? It's not fair and we don't want it. Just gut reaction. And so, you know, we just kind of worked that issue of, if we drop this number, it'll make sense to more people, and maybe we'll develop the type of housing that we, you know, really could use. And in fact, we learned that some of the smaller less density housing had some cost savings as well, because of the way that you build the structures for the taller buildings and higher buildings, it costs a lot more. You need to build garages, and it's not so much cheaper because you need less space because you're going higher. There are also some other costs. And so that was a little bit of how we kind of figured it out to make that work, to get that number to finally drop from 30 to 20. So what's gonna happen now? Marin's gonna have to build some affordable housing, otherwise I lose all my credibility.
For people who don't care about your credibility,
yeah.
What really will happen?
Well, if so this has a sunset. So we negotiated a sunset in this. So in 8 years, if Marin doesn't build any more housing, we're going to go back to Metropolitan, and we're going to be right back where we began. But if we show that we're successful building housing at that density, I'm pretty confident we're going to be able to stay at Suburban.
Okay, I'm going to take another question at this table and then be working my way back across the room.
Hi there, my name is Nini Nursioli. I'm a member of the Friends of the Canal, and I also have a family business on the San Rafael Canal. I'm not sure how familiar you are with the issue, but the San Rafael Canal has been silting in for years now. The last full dredge was in 2002, and there's only a partial dredge in 2011, where most of the businesses actually wasn't even dredged. The Army Corps of Engineers has said openly that they don't have the funding anymore because it had always been funded through earmarks, and that they need at least 30% down to help dredge the canal. Is there anything you can do to help?
I'd be glad to help, and you know, I don't know too much more about this issue than I did when I was on the City Council, when we relied on the Army Corps to do this work, and so I haven't heard about it since I left the council in 2012. If there's a way that I can be helpful, that'd be fantastic. To leverage whatever resources that we can, and of course to advocate to the federal agencies to make sure that money is there. The canal is a tremendous resource in San Rafael, but I don't think we've really maximized it in a way that we can.
Okay, going over to this side of the room, I see a hand up here.
On the subject of affordable housing, Winship and Corte Madera appears to remain unoccupied. Could you update us on that?
I'm not qualified to update you on that specific development. I think maybe someone from Corte Madera, from the council, or the owner. I know that it definitely had some delays in it being built, and it's not affordable housing. I think 10% of those units are affordable. That is market rate housing. And so Marin, just like the entire Bay Area, is really struggling on, you know, having housing stock, both market rate and affordable. We don't have enough market rate housing for the demand that's there, or we do, and it drives up our housing values. So that, you know, it's just that's that balance that we've got that Marin's always going to struggle with, because you know, we've preserved a lot of land and wisely did that, and puts a lot of other pressure on the community and obviously on our highways.
Well, I noticed that the Planning Commission in Marin has not adhered to the 20 units per acre. They're going back to the 30. I've noticed that several times on different projects. So your bill, is that a law that has to be adhered to, or what?
So it's a floor, not a ceiling. So they can go higher than that, as much as they want. That makes sense for that space. So again, in San Rafael, a lot of the affordable housing developments actually have 90 unit per acre density, 100 unit per acre density, and it actually fits really well into that downtown core of San Rafael. I didn't even know that it was affordable housing. So, you know, what's 30 units per acre look like? Not as big as those other projects that were developed. So it may work, it might not. I'm not part of those planning decisions for Marin County, but they have the flexibility. I think that's the most important thing. Now, the onus is on them to show that they can develop the housing that we need.
Okay, over here, and then I'll come to this table.
Hi, Mark. Jenny Morales with CSPP. And my question is the same one we ask you after your first year in the Assembly. What is the legislature going to do about reforming the pension system to save this county and this state? And at the time you said they don't even want to talk about it. They won't even listen to me. Has anything changed? Will anything change, or will it take an initiative from the public to finally get through to do something meaningful? Thanks.
I don't think much has changed.
You told us the big number. I mean, everybody knows the big number. Doesn't that concern them enough to want to act on it to prevent it from growing?
Unfortunately, I don't see it being a motivator, and I don't know if we're going to need to wait until the next recession. We have done a little bit more on CalSTRS and teacher pensions. The school districts do not appreciate it. So the school districts will come to us and say, well, we've got more money, but it's not going to the classroom. To which I reply, you made promises that you now need to keep, and you need to explain that is why it's not going to the classroom. But the state is, you know, has passed laws that say that the schools have to start contributing more on that. So there in certain places we're doing better. UC just shifted to just change to adopt PEPRA. It did not have to adopt PEPRA in 2012, but it is now. And so, you know, I think piecemeal some things are happening to have it make more sense. But there's no overwhelming push to do this. And I think the Governor Brown has a lot of other things on his plate.
All right, so we're going to take two more questions, the two here, and then you'll have a chance to give a short wrap-up.
Okay. So, Barbara.
Hi, Mark. Barbara Rosen. Not long ago, PUC agreed to PG&E's request to charge an exit fee for people who opt for Marin Clean Energy. Of course, it seems wrong to me, but how could that happen when we're supposed to be choosing cleaner energy?
Yeah. So I disagreed with that decision by the PUC. So just this morning, before I drove here, I was at a press conference on a bill that I'm a joint author of with Assemblymember Mike Gatto to dissolve the PUC. And you know, if you look at the PUC, it's you know, it manages moving companies, trains, taxis, energy companies, cell phones, you name it, trains. Did I say trains already? It manages so many different things. And the question isn't, is it too big to fail? Is it too big to succeed? And if you look at how they've dealt with the San Bruno explosion, the decommissioning of the nuclear plant at San Onofre, and the deal making that was done to push those costs onto ratepayers in those examples and not on the utilities. And the backroom deals made by PUC commissioners who, you know, are under investigation for a lot of that stuff, that the PUC is rife with dysfunction and was developed in a time to deal with the train industry and corruption in the train industry many moons ago. And so I think it's time to break the PUC up. That's not going to come easy. It will require a constitutional amendment because the PUC is enshrined in the Constitution. So we can disagree about the exit fee, but there are a lot of, that's a symptom of the problem at PUC. And so, you know, I somewhat feel like maybe there's a theme when I'm looking at MTC not working or PUC not working, and I'm not leading the charge on the PUC breakup. I'm giving that to my colleague, Mike Gatto from the Burbank-Glendale area. But it's time for reform-minded lawmakers to engage in making government work. And this is a move to do that.
Brad, you've got our last question.
Oh, thank you. I imagine that usually you get complaints wherever you go, and that's probably usual, but I would like to offer a thank you, which may be rare. Thank you for your co-authorship of the Disclose Act, which a syndicated columnist said last year was perhaps the most important bill in Sacramento and would require, it's bad enough that we have unlimited special interest funding, but even if we have to have that, which the Supreme Court said we did in Citizens United, the fact that it is not disclosed as to who's actually paying for it is a terrible thing, and even that noted liberal Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Antonin Scalia, said we at least ought to know who's paying for it. So instead of saying paid for by Citizens for a Better California, you don't know who's paying for Citizens for a Better California, wouldn't it be nice in plain print if it said paid for by Chevron, Mobil, and Exxon? That's something we ought to have the right to know. So thank you for that bill and for passing a landmark victory last week, 60-15, which didn't make the press, despite the fact that 80-90% of both Democrats and Republicans want this. Yeah. And my question is, what's the will it pass the Senate again this time? Because I think in the last cycle it passed the Senate but not the Assembly. Mm-hmm. Who's opposing this? And what's the obstacle? And what will happen in the Senate?
So the bill that that Greg's talking about, I jointly authored that with Assemblymember Jimmy Gomez, who really went to the mat with labor unions to get them to remove their opposition to the bill. And it's really striking. You know, you've got all this special interest money behind ballot initiatives, and they don't want to reveal who they are. And you think, well, it's the Koch brothers or, you know, Chevron. Who are the bad guys lurking behind there? And it's everybody. And I feel like the business interests really didn't have to oppose the bill because they were able to rely on the labor unions to oppose the bill. And so it's kind of, everyone really didn't want to reveal who they were.
Not all labor unions.
Just a few. And I mean, you know, if you do a poll and you say, you know, do people like me? And some corporations or some unions are liked more than others. And I think that was one of the issues is, if our name is on there, will that hurt our cause? And so they like to hide behind the innocuous names. So this bill required two-thirds. Anytime you amend the Political Reform Act, it requires a two-thirds vote. So we needed to have both Democrats and Republicans. We needed to keep all the Democrats. We didn't know how many Republicans we could get. And we were able to get, I think, nine Republicans in the Assembly to vote for this, which was huge. It's not one or two, it was nine, very significant. This had passed the Senate in the past when the Democrats had two-thirds in the Senate, and I don't know if they had Republicans up on that bill at that time. I think that there will be a couple of Republicans that are willing to go up on it this time. I think that they need to get two, and so I am hopeful that they'll be able to do that. It's an election year, and if we were able to get nine, it'd be nice to think that they'd be able to get two of them. It's a significant bill. Because anytime that you can shine more light on the money in politics, that is good for voters, and it's going to be good for public policy to know who are the groups trying to influence your vote. And quite frankly, they're trying to get you either not to vote or to vote. Some do like turning off voters, because if you affect turnout, you can get you can really mold who is turning up that day to vote to get the win or the defeat that you're looking for.
So do you want to give us a 1 or 2 minute wrap-up of word from Sacramento, kind of pulling it all together?
Well, I think you've heard it all, right? And I really kind of let it all out. I didn't hold back. I really wanted to give you guys some insight as to the work that I do, how frustrating it can be. But there's also some really amazing things that we do every day. So I had this week, I had a water bond hearing, and I had about 22 students from San Geronimo Elementary School come up and sit in the rafters, in the balcony of the hearing room, and watch it. And I was able to go run up to them to chat with them after the hearing. I had students from San Pedro Elementary out on Point San Pedro in San Rafael up last week. And you see, those were fourth graders. And you get to see these kids, you get to say, I'm from your hometown, and just hear from them and kind of get a sense of, what do they care about? What are they like? One of my best bills last year was a bill I developed with students from Manor Elementary School. And they came up to Sacramento, talked with my staff, we were talking about the drought, and they said, what about only planting plants that don't need a lot of water on state land? And so we drafted a bill about drought-tolerant landscaping on state land, highways, parks, anywhere that the state has any structure or whatever, only drought-tolerant landscaping can be put in there, because these Manor Elementary School students, brainstormed this idea with me. So it's not just getting this great idea and the governor signed the bill. At every committee hearing, the fourth graders testified. They were up there on the mic, sitting there just like every well-heeled lobbyist does. They were in those seats. And I'll get to that. They were so impressive because they spoke right into the mic. You got all these, I'm sure we looked like a bunch of old men. All these guys behind and women behind the dais, kind of in judgment of these people providing the testimony. And, they just were very brave to make their point, make their statement. And it made me very proud to represent them. And it made all the other members envious. Mark, how can I get a class up here to do a bill with me? I gotta get one of those bills. And so I think we're going to see a whole lot more of that from others, and I'm gonna do a bill with all of elementary school in Novato this year on something that I get to, this is the best part of my job, and I tell all the kids that come up to visit, if you like to learn something new every day, this is a great job. It's like going to school. I don't get to decide what I wanna learn often, but if I want to, I can learn as much about it as I want. So I got to learn about seed exchanges and seed banks, and we actually have a seed bank, I think over at Hall Middle School, and we've got a really big one at the Grange up in Sebastopol, but these schools also are very involved in these seed exchanges. And so we're doing a bill to help them kind of, we don't like regulations, right? Too many regulations on seeds. So these are all natural seeds, that kind of thing, and too many regulations on how they do the seed exchanges. And we want to make it easier for people to share and exchange seeds and grow their gardens. And so we've developed this with the students at Olivet Elementary School. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. And so I'm looking forward to doing it again. We're not just doing a bill with a bunch of students because it's fun to do a bill with students. They're actually coming with meaningful ideas that are going to help real problems in the state. And so that's essentially when they've got a kernel of an idea, just to kind of go off of the seed metaphor, then we talk with other stakeholders. Then we approach, the Granges. There's actually a group for the seed exchange folks, and actually found out this is actually a real issue that we can deal with. And that's exciting for me to learn something new, to do something that's really district-oriented this way. We end up dealing with a lot of big state issues, but sometimes when we're able to kind of make things easier for, even if it's a small crowd of folks here at home, it's a pretty cool experience to do. And they're gonna yank me off of here, but your politician has the microphone, you wanna stay up here forever. I love representing Marin and Sonoma. It is an amazing community. It also is the envy of a lot of other members across the state. People talk to me all the time, even lobbyists will say, oh, I just spent the weekend in your district. And I get that all the time. And so it makes me really proud to represent it. It's a total honor to represent it. And the best thing, it's not all the bills we do. People call my office every day asking for help. If you ever need a hand with anything, whether it's health insurance, disability insurance, the franchise tax board, don't get frustrated. Just call me and we can help make things a little bit easier for you and hopefully resolve any issues that you have. Thank you guys.